This episode is sponsored by Molly Morris over at M3 Virtual Accounting. If you have an online business, like a podcast, for example, you can sign up for a free consultation with Molly to find out if her services will work for you, and it will take off so much stress come tax time next year. So check her out at m3virtualaccounting.com and get your free consultation today.
This is an Unspoiled Network podcast.
This is Unspoiled, covering the Dresden Files, Book 16, Battleground, Chapters 23, 24, and 25. In these chapters, Harry attempts to kill Rudolph, makes him shit himself and piss himself. Very satisfying in its way, I won't lie. But then he has to fight both Sonya and Butters, and we hate it. Welcome to Unspoiled. Welcome to the show, everyone. I am Natasha.
I'm Rashawn.
Okay. So Rashawn started to talk to me about some stuff, and I said, save it for the podcast. Honestly, normally when somebody's like, save it, they don't mean save it. They just mean stop talking. But when I said it, I meant actually save it. And I wanted to discuss it a bit. So before we even like get into recapping things, What is your vibe right now?
I was just, you know, I was reading and I was thinking to myself, like, this is not what I come to this universe for.
Mm-hmm.
And the timing is just terrible for me personally.
Yeah.
And for the state of the world in general, which just seems to just be accelerating towards, I don't know, some sort of inevitable fucking ball
collapse.
Of fire.
Yep.
And it's just, it's so dark and it's so heavy. And I'm not saying that it's bad. I'm not saying it's poor writing or poor plotting or the story is terrible. I'm not making that kind of judgment at all.
Mm-hmm.
What I am saying is, my God, man. The relentlessness of it. You know what I mean? Like, every fucking chapter seems like it's ending on a note that is darker and worse than the one before. And mm-hmm. Can I get a fucking break somewhere in my media? Something, somewhere. Mm-hmm. Like, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So, I know there was much talk about this book before we started it. You know, a mm-hmm. lot of people had a lot of feelings. You had a lot of feelings.
Sure did.
I think I am starting to get what a lot of those feelings are about. Now, granted, people had to be really careful about their feelings with me anyway, you know, because nobody wanted to spoil me.
Mm-hmm.
So what I got was really a vague sort of impression and overall kind of sentiment that, like, you know what I mean?
Yep, definitely.
Without knowing the particulars of things. But as I progress through the book, I'm starting to be like, oh, that's what that energy was.
Mm-hmm.
That's what people were kind of, like, talking around in order to not spoil me. Like, I see.
Yeah, I didn't even, like, try. I didn't really even want to tell you that I didn't like it, but I feel like I definitely gave that energy out anyway. But just because, like, I don't like it when people who are spoiled and I'm covering something tell me, oh, I didn't like something coming up. Mm-hmm. Don't tell me anything like that. You're giving an impression already, and it just sort of, like, fucks with the whole process of the thing.
It does. It it impacts your expectations, even if you don't realize it. Mm-hmm. Like, I'll find myself being like, oh, is this it? Is this it? Is this the thing? We're you talking about this? Is this the thing that's happening now? You know?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Like, you start reading or watching, whatever the case may be, searching for the thing that the person referenced, you
exactly.
know,
trying,
instead of just being in the moment of enjoying whatever it is you're reading or watching.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
Yeah, I saw like some study that said like people being spoiled, it doesn't actually impact their enjoyment of a thing. And I would just like to respond with like a complete, you sure? Because I don't really know how you measure the enjoyment of a thing being spoiled versus not spoiled when there's no possible way to measure that. There's no, you can't have somebody experience something completely unspoiled and then have them go back having seen it already and then do your calculations. Like,
right.
There's no way to know that. So I don't really buy it.
I have said, and I've said on the podcast, that I can enjoy something when I have been spoiled.
Sure.
But that is a far cry from what their premise was.
Exactly.
Right?
Yep.
Like, I believe it's possible to enjoy a piece of art, even if you've been spoiled by it.
Mm-hmm.
However, I don't think there's a way to quantify that, it's enjoyable. It's just as enjoyable. Like,
yeah.
How?
There's just no way to like do a study like that on the same piece of media, and that's supposed to be like your control. So how do you even like judge something like that? And like personally, I kind of have an issue nowadays with the culture of like, we're going to release a bunch of interviews about a movie that's coming out, and we're going to release like a series of different trailers that all show slightly different things. And everybody is going to have 1,000 opinions on a movie that hasn't even been released yet based on interview commentary and trailers, which are not going to be an accurate representation of fucking anything. And then you go into a movie with like a certain kind of attitude based on all this shit that you've been reading and consuming and opinions that you've been like exposed to that have no basis in the product. It's just the like hypotheses surrounding the product.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't like that either. So just what I'm saying is there's a reason my shit's unspoiled.
I guess it occurs to me that I guess as far as like people enjoy it as much whether it's spoiled or not, the only way you could do that is if you had like two groups of people and you gave them the same thing to read and one group is spoiled and one group is not, and then you rate their... You compare their levels of enjoyment.
But they might just not like something that somebody else likes.
But then that's the thing, too, right? Like, at the end of the day, how do you know? Like, group A was spoiled and group B wasn't spoiled. And at the end, both groups came out and everybody rated the book, you know, gave it A's across the board.
Mm-hmm.
I guess that you could then take that and say, see, it doesn't matter. Both groups enjoyed it equally.
I posit there is no way to measure something like that. I reject the premise, and I will not interact with that kind of like argument that people like to have about this, because that once that got released, it sparked some discussion because of what I do, and I was just like, no, I'm not playing this game. There's no point anyway. Like, oh, well, you know, people like it better. So what? Do you want me to just change my whole entire, like, premise of my network? Is that what you're trying to tell me? That I just like, oh, well, you should just be spoiled, actually. Yeah, okay. That's a great idea, James. Leave me alone. Anyway, I have feelings about things.
No shade to any James that may be listening.
No, shade to Jameses everywhere. You know what you did. Somewhere James is going, she's right, I do know.
Somewhere else and James is like, God damn it, she's on us.
I have to call an emergency meeting of James's.
The meeting of the James.
It's the summit of James. Anyway, so yeah, and like Rashawn's feeling of, she used the word relentless. And that is the exact word that I used to describe this book when I was feeling like frustrated by it, was it's relentless. It really is. And you are reading it in parcels, which I actually think helps some. Because we are getting it. No, but listen, you're getting it broken up into sections of a specific plot and certain arcs that are happening within certain areas. And that helps to make it feel less monotonous, if you can believe this. If you are binging this book, everything blends together into one endless chapters and chapters and chapters long battle. And it feels so much more one note to me.
I can see that.
You know?
Yeah.
I've actually been pleasantly surprised on the reread, breaking it up, how much, like, actual small story beats there are in areas that I had forgotten, because everything blurs into this sort of giant, like, blood fest kind of thing, you know?
Yeah, I can see that now that you mention it. There are, it's so funny that, like, I feel so far removed from what was happening at the beginning of the book.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it feels like the beginning of this book was three books ago.
Yeah. Yep.
Like, Thomas is still, like, being hidden on Demon Reach.
Right.
And that feels like that was three books ago.
Yeah, I guess that was, like, he had been hidden at the end of the previous book. So this book started with them leaving the island.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, yeah, still feels like the same book. On, really is supposed to have been, so it's fine.
But, this chapter, the first one, chapter 23, and I had a conversation with, Cam, I don't think that they would mind me sharing. Hopefully they don't mind. They checked in on me after last week to see how I was doing, because it was a really heavy chapter and everything.
Yeah.
And I shared that I was a little concerned, because I know when we do the live read, when it's a big, big reveal in a book that we're covering, you know, there can sometimes be an expectation, you know, really, like, wanting to hear my reaction in real time. Like, that's the whole point of it.
Mm-hmm.
And I was saying how I think that my reaction was maybe even a little bit more subdued, because I was really trying to numb, because I wasn't going to be able to separate, like, my own, like, real life, you know, grief from the book. Right. And I didn't want it to, like, spill all out. So I was trying to, like, really, like, rein it in. So we got through that chapter, and I was like, all right, well, we got through that. And then chapter 23 really had me in tears. Mm-hmm. Again, I'm still, like, I'm all over the place emotionally, you know. But it turned out that this was much more emotional than I expected it to be. And I knew that Harry was going to be out for blood. I mean, he made that very clear at the end of that last chapter.
Yep.
I knew that Butters would not allow it, and that Sonya could not allow it, right? So I knew that, that would come into play, and that Harry would have to deal with both of them, right?
Yep.
And so that all happened pretty much exactly the way I expected it to, because it was the only option. Of course, that's how it goes. I'm not like I'm a genius that I figured it out. Like, that's just what it had to be.
Mm-hmm.
But I didn't expect it to be as emotional as it was. So I guess we should talk about, how Harry Dresden was really about to fuck Rudolph up in every way imaginable, and how here for it I was, even knowing that, like, he could not just murder a person, and that it would do more damage to him than it would to Rudolph and all of the other stuff, right? Can't have him go to the dark side so completely, and blah, 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 blah. All that said, I was still here for it.
Yep.
I'd have been like, yep, go ahead.
Yep.
And whatever consequences that have to be faced after Harry does that, you know what? We'll figure out how to deal with that shit then.
Yep. You are not alone in that sentiment, let me tell you that. Everybody was just like, just fucking let him die. Yeah. Fuck. Like,
you know, like, oh, but it would do more damage. It would basically be Harry killing himself. He could never come back from that. I beg to differ.
Yeah, same.
I think he could come back from it. I think he'd have been all right. I really think he'd have been okay.
I don't know. Maybe it's just that I have never actually, like, taken a life that I know of. But I like using it. You know that whole, like, that I know of when guys are like, do I have any kids? None that I know of. I like doing that for murder. Nobody that I've killed that I know of.
I like doing that for kids. I used to say that. I thought it was really funny, the idea that, like, yeah, maybe I popped the kid out and I just don't fucking remember. Who the fuck? What you gonna tell me that I didn't? Like, you don't know me. And I would, people would ask me if I had any kids, and I'd be like, yeah, no, not that I know of. I don't think so. And then it's such a weird thing to hear a woman say that they would, their faces would do this really funny thing, and I never got tired of it.
Let them figure it out. I don't know what it means, but it means whatever you think it means.
So, yeah.
Yeah.
I like, too, that he was going to, like, murder Rudolph in such a way that it was going to be, like, up close and personal.
Mm-hmm.
I really, really enjoyed the bones when he, like, his wrist snaps and he hears a finger break and he's
just like, yes!
I loved how intimate it was. Mm-hmm. I loved that it wasn't just, like, I mean, later on, magic did show up because he tried to throw that fucking lightning bolt at him but that was after they got in his fucking way,
right?
Like, but once, like, Sonya and Butters interfered, then Harry had to, like, you know, figure out some other ways to get the job done.
Well, and also Sonya put his, like, arm back in its socket because his arm was still dislocated at the beginning of the fight, and that was part of why he couldn't cast. But then Sonya, like, tosses him and his arm goes back in again. So he's just like, oh good, now I can throw magic around.
But what I thought was what I found to be emotional that was surprising to me was both Sonya and Butters, and how they talked to Harry.
Yeah.
And why, while they were interfering, a nice person would be like, is it an intervention or an interference? It's an interference.
Yep. Agreed.
But the compassion and love that they had for Harry, even while they're trying to keep him from doing this thing that he can't come back from, or that they're afraid that he could never come back from, because I'm on the fence about whether or not he could actually come back.
Mm-hmm.
And Butters especially, because he is hurting as well, and the loss for him of Karen means something to Butters too.
Yeah.
You know? It was a lot. It was emotionally a lot, even though it's not a very long chapter. And fucking Harry takes Sonya in a fight. And I wasn't certain that that was a thing that would happen.
Right.
You guys. Mm-hmm. But yeah, he does. And he fucking bites his ear off, pulls a Mike Tyson and shit. He tries to kick him in the groin.
He straight tries to kick him in the balls. And thankfully, Sonya, like, saw it coming, I guess? It was just like, no, you don't. But, oh, man. I hate him. And it's really interesting, the different vibe, because Butters is just like, dude, I know. Mm-hmm. But I'm not trying to save him, though.
Mm-hmm.
Sonya is like, that is not your job. I'm going to say this one time. One more time. And you had better stop. They have a very different, like, energy to them about it.
Yeah. And he tells, Sonya says, you know, this man, you know, that you're trying to kill, Sonya says, if he has done wrong, he will face justice, but not like this.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't mean to, like, not trying to pick or split hairs, but, and maybe that's the point, because Sonya is so firmly planted in the, it is not for me to pass judgment.
Mm-hmm.
It's not for any of us, really, to pass judgment, right?
Right.
So he doesn't even say, like, this man will get it. You don't have to do it. Don't, you know, this man fucked up, blah, blah, blah. He even, if he's done wrong, he will face justice. As opposed to just, you know, being like, I know, you know, he's done wrong. Mm-hmm. There's not even, like, I don't know. It's just, I don't know if that's because, is Sonya not, like, there when he killed? Is he late to the scene?
Yeah, he isn't there for it. Yeah, that's why when he shows up, he just says, what is going on here? Because he isn't even aware why Harry is doing this. He just walks up on Harry, slowly killing
him. Right, because the first thing he's like, what are you doing? That's right.
Yeah.
And Harry's just like, you know. Also, I love how, like, matter of fact, Harry is.
Yo.
Harry's like, give me 2 minutes.
I'm just writing these scales almost real done. Quick. At one point, he says, like, hold on, I said, or just a minute, as if I were in the middle of making a sandwich. And the way that James Marsters delivers that line, he's in the middle of fucking, like, crushing this man to death. And he just goes, just a minute. This very, like, almost friendly sounding tone. And it was so creepy to think of him being that vaguely cheery as this man is, like, starting to cough blood up because his lungs are being punctured by his broken ribs kind of thing, you know?
It's an interesting read. Later on, he does say, like, a sandwich. Like, when Sonya comes up, he says he snarls. Mm-hmm. And then Rudolph made a gurgling sound. But then later on, he tells Sonya, yeah, he killed Murphy. I'm going to balance those scales. And then we'll get to work. But yeah, so he goes, him and Sonya fight. You know, they throw a couple of fists back and forth. And Harry gets the better of him. Which, again, I was really surprised. And then Butters pops up. And the way Butters is dealing with him, like you just said, it's very different from Sonya.
Yeah.
And I guess, again, it's not surprising because Butters has a relationship with Harry and with Murphy and then with them as a couple. And just says, no, he's more involved.
Yeah.
This is much more personal.
And he saw it happen. I feel like if Sonya had actually seen it, it would also just be different, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, Butters tells him that, you know, he's not trying to protect Rudolph, he's trying to protect Harry. And then he brings the Sword of Faith out, and Harry ends up, like, it ends up catching his arm.
Harry tries to hit Butters, like, backhand him across the face, and Butters parries his hit with the sword and catches Harry's the back of his arm. That he was going to try and hit him with.
And that, that Harry feels the pain of that in a way that he doesn't feel really pain at all.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Anymore, right?
Yep.
There is something, I guess it's God, in this that makes the sword be able to cut through the Winter Mantle. Like, just completely, like, unplugs it. You know, it's like the battery died on the Winter Mantle. And not only does he reel from the pain of being burned, but, like, he's feeling all the pains of all the things,
mm-hmm.
you know, that his body has been going through forever, however long. And the suddenness of it overwhelms him, and he just drops. And there's a bit where when he goes down, it says that Harry says that he felt Rudolph and he felt his terror and his agony and his confusion, his humiliation, his remorse, da 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 da. He felt all of them as if they were his own, and that he even saw himself through Rudolph's eyes and, like, sees a monster and then thinks of Karen and then thinks of, like, oh my God, what would she have thought if she had seen that?
Yeah. You know?
And he's just completely undone by the enormous grief of everything.
Mm-hmm.
And Butters just kind of holds him while he sobs.
Yeah.
And then I cried as I was reading this because it's just, you know, Butter's telling him that he's here, I'm here, and Harry realizing, like, how close he came to crossing a line that he was pretty, you know, that a line that's also important to Harry. It's not important to me. But apparently it's important to Harry to not cross that line. And just sort of reckoning with how close he came, that he hurt his friends, that Murphy would have been ashamed of him, he says, or he thinks, that she would have been terrified for him. And
when he yells at Sonia, he, like, says self-righteous loudmouth, he calls him. Which mm-hmm. I was like, God, I just hate him, like, insulting them in this way. And the fighting is one thing. But once you start, like, throwing words out with it, it starts to feel a lot more personal. If it's just the fight, it's like, I'm just trying to do a thing and you're interrupting me doing a thing. But then once it's, like, a personal insult, I'm just like, okay, now you're just being mean.
And he says that to Sonia after Sonia goes down.
Mm-hmm.
So he's on the ground. He's been bested in this moment, at least. He's dropped the sword, and Harry says that to him as he's already down, which in my mind is somehow worse. Because it's not even like he blurted it out while they were engaged in the fight. You know? He just kind of like spits it out after Sonya's already down. And then tells him that this is no concern of yours. And then the next line is that the hate was calling me,
mm-hmm.
and I had no time for further distractions, as satisfying as they might have been. And that is a really powerful, short little line.
The hate was calling me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he goes, like, to turn around. Again, like, he even says, like a predator, like, his eyes go back to, like, where is Rudolph, who at this point is just, like, curled up on the ground, you know, laying in his own fucking waste. And Harry is about to, like, attack him and not just kill him, but make it gruesome and make it painful and probably make it last a very long time. And he turns around to Rudolph, and Butters is down there next to him, probably, like, attending to him in some fashion or trying to. And then that's when he ends up dealing with Butters. And luckily, I guess, you know, the contact with the sword is what breaks this hate spell.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, and he mentions, too, this is... He says, the stench of my own charred flesh filled my nose, somehow laced with the scent of sulfur, brimstone. And I'm wondering if it's, like, the sword that makes that smell, like, it's, like, the fires of damnation because you're being judged for what you were about to try and do, and that's why you were injured. Or if that's supposed to be, like, is just, does Harry's flesh smell like that? Like, what? Where? Why would the sword of faith smell like brimstone when I thought that wasn't, like, supposed to be the point of it? Pun intended.
Right.
But you get what I mean.
Yeah. I wonder, like, when...
This is brought up in the Discord, by the way, so...
When he first makes contact, I thought that... This is really weird. For some reason, I was under the impression that the sword couldn't hurt, like, someone who wasn't, you know, evil, for lack of a better word.
Okay.
I'm just going to use it as, like, a shorthand real quick. So, the fact that it even hurts Harry, I was like, oh, that can't be good. But I don't know why I think that. I can't remember if that's, like, a real thing or not.
Well, we saw Sonia pretend to get his hand cut off. Do you remember that? In the practice fight?
Yeah. Because
it did just go through his hand.
Right.
But it's, I don't remember if Harry tries it out or if it's just that, like, well, yeah, he's a fucking Knight of the Cross. Of course it didn't cut his hand off. You know, I don't remember.
Yeah. So I think that's why I was really startled that it did anything to Harry.
Mm-hmm.
But then, like, when you take a minute to think about it, you're like, well, the mindset that he was in, of course it would. But also, I think I think that the fact that he is also not really human in the strictest sense.
He is, though.
Well, he is, but he isn't. Like, all right. Human, he's human. But he also has a lot of other shit going on. So I started thinking, well, is it the mantle? And I'm trying to stay away from judgments like, you know, good and evil.
Right, yeah.
But I'm wondering if by having the winter mantle, that somehow makes him something other than just strictly human. And maybe that's why. So maybe the sword has contact with Harry and is able to hurt him. Not necessarily because he was in a murderous rage, but because also, you know, he's not strictly speaking just, you know, a regular vanilla, you know, mortal.
Right.
But I don't know. And then the brimstone thing, yeah. That makes me think that I wish we had heard of other vanquished people and what it smelled like.
Mm.
Like when Butters fights Nicodemus, right?
Yeah. He doesn't get strike in.
No, because Nicodemus like flutters away, right?
Yeah, flutters.
Doesn't Butters get contact with somebody?
I don't recall.
Well, either way, I wish I either remembered or B, it had been mentioned that sulfur and brimstone smell is standard.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't think it's ever come up before. So I don't know if that's supposed to be something specific for Harry or if that's just how Butter's thing works.
Yeah,
now.
Yeah.
Like, maybe that's just how his sword works. Also, the other swords don't burn.
Exactly.
So, you know, he is the only one with this fancy lightsaber.
Yeah, so, there's no precedent.
Yeah.
It's unprecedented. Yeah, this is when he says, in its wake, I broke. I sobbed. And he is just all of a sudden like, oh my God, what had I almost done? Murph would have been so ashamed. He took her. He took her from me. He took her from all of us. And he'll answer for it before the law, Harry, but it can't happen like this. You can't let it happen like this. We need you. You, the good man. I can't let you hurt that man. Too many of us need him. Your daughter needs him. It was the last phrase that did it. It hit me like a bucket of cold water. So, the right thing to say. I like the idea that the Almighty is in Butters being like, mention his daughter, because he seems to have forgotten about that child, and that will help.
There's a thing in the next chapter when he talks about having to put this grief away for the time being, and he talks about how much loss he's had in his life, and how it's going to suck for a while, probably a long time. It's really, really going to suck. But that, you know, eventually you kind of figure out a way to live with it.
Mm-hmm.
And it is a really, in my opinion, a very accurate description of what it is like to live with grief after you lose someone that's important to you. And I like, too, that he talks about, like, he says something like, I didn't try to repress it. I didn't try to hide it. I just put it away, which is something that some therapists will actually like recommend that you do sometimes.
Yeah.
You know, like if there's something and you can't deal with it right now, it's okay to put it aside and just be like, all right, I'm not saying you don't exist, problem. You know, I'm not saying you don't exist, loss and grief. I'm just saying for right now, I'm going to put you in this little cabinet so I can get, you know, X, Y, and Z done.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'll come back to you. I also really liked it when this crisis is sort of averted and Harry is brought back to sort of his senses. Sonya is just like, you fight dirty like a Russian and like laughs about it.
Yeah. Yep.
And then Harry tries to stand up, and he's apologizing to Butters. He sees Sonya and, like, cries when he sees him, and he's, like, humiliated and ashamed of his behavior. And Sonya consoles him and tells him that, you know, it's okay. And Harry can't stay upright anymore. And he almost falls over. And it just says, my friends caught me and they held me. And Butters kept saying, you know, I'm here, Harry. And Harry just whispers, she's gone. And all Butters keeps saying is, I know, I'm here, I'm here. And then he just cries. And it just, whew, you guys. It was a lot.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
All right. So then, chapter 24. Sonya and his people that he has been training and organizing are taking care of business. The volunteers stalked forward, killing huntsmen whose spears, while terrifying and destructive, really weren't up to exchanging fire with pump-action guns while outnumbered 5 or 6 to 1.
Mm.
I don't know how long I was out of the fight. Butters told me later it had only been a few minutes. All I know is that after a time, the physical pain began to recede, and I felt the winter mantle settle around me again. I love the description of how he's been, like, sobbing, crying, and he has a broken nose, and it's just extremely undignified that he has to, like, snarf and clear himself out.
Yeah. The winter mantle comes back up, and everything kind of goes back to the way it had been, except the burn on his arm. The winter mantle can't do anything about that.
Yeah.
Which I thought was, how about that?
Yep.
I guess the winter mantle... up against God just doesn't have the juice, huh?
Or it's like the mantle. I mean, I guess it makes sense with the Fae. If Butters's assertions about how it works are correct, the mantle doesn't actually give Harry any extra power or pain resistance. It just amplifies things that already exist but aren't meant to be utilized every day, all the time.
Mm-hmm.
So it's basically a glamour. It's like an illusion. And the whole thing with these swords is when they come out, they clarify and purify and make things crisp and clear. Mm-hmm. So it's just gonna cut through all of the bullshit, pun intended, and be like, I know what that thing is trying to tell you, but the fact is, you are burned, sir. And you are going to notice. So I know that this whole little thing here is meant to be very convenient, but we don't play with that.
Mm-hmm.
And honestly, Harry, I am still so nervous about the mantle and, like, its long-term effects on his body. I think about it all the time.
His body is just going to be ruined,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
when this is all over. Harry is sort of taking comfort in the pain because he says it makes him feel human.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really an inopportune time, you know, in the middle of this battle, you know, for him to be feeling any kind of pain. Like, if there's any time where you want him to be on 100 with, like, nothing holding him back or inhibiting him, this is the moment, yep, for that. But yet it turns out that feeling this pain, I guess you're running around with a winter mantle and you start to feel less than human because you are doing things that humans aren't necessarily supposed to be able to do.
Yeah.
You know? Between, like, suffering injuries and running and lifting and strength and all this other shit. And this injury reminds him, I guess I am still just like a human man, though,
mm-hmm,
underneath all of this. And then there's this whole bit about, he doesn't want to come right out and say that pain is what defines us. And I'm just like, why not? Just lean into it. It feels very clear to me that is exactly what it is. But he doesn't want to, like, make a bold statement. So he says, you know, I'm not saying pain is what defines us, but in many ways, it's what unites us. And that we all recognize other people in pain. And he begins to talk a little bit about how our natural instinct when we see someone in pain is to try to help them,
mm-hmm,
and lessen their pain. And he says that pain is really when our bodies are working properly, which his is not. Pain is a teacher. It is a tough, strict, and perfectly fair teacher.
Caveat being, when our bodies are working properly. It's not fair a lot of the time. Mm-hmm. Because our bodies often don't work properly. So then it's not a teacher. It's just a burden.
Yeah. But when you think about, like, one of the things that Butters also said when talking about the mantle is that it is the glamour, as you described it, which I really like the idea that it's just being a very elaborate glamour, is that it doesn't let Harry's body teach him the things it should be teaching him. Mm-hmm. Telling him when it's time to slow down. Telling him something is too heavy. No, you shouldn't lift that thing. No, you shouldn't do your body that way, you know?
Yeah.
It's been silenced. And he's just out here parkouring all over the fucking place, you know?
True.
Like he doesn't have a care in the world. And so, yeah, he finds it reassuring. He says, I didn't enjoy the steady pain, but I found it immensely reassuring. So, yeah, he puts the grief and everything right now aside. And they have a bit of a plan. But before that, they need to get Murphy from where she is to someplace else.
Yeah.
Because right now, she's just kind of laying wherever in the street or wherever they are when they ran into Rudolph. Outside that daycare center, I guess, mm-hmm, right? Mm-hmm. That's where all this went down. So, yeah, we have him picking her up and taking her back through the park. And he sees Matt. It's really funny later on when he actually almost bumps into yes. her. He sees Mab, and she takes one look. She sees him. He's carrying Murphy, and all she says is, "You've returned." And he tells Mab that basically Murphy deserves to be laid with dignity because she's a warrior and that she slayed a giant. She's a giant slayer. She deserves to be laid with dignity. And Mab agrees. No back and forth. No little, like, you know, sideway comments. You know, nothing. Just, and so she does. And she instructs the warriors that this warrior is to be laid in state. And that she shared our enemies. And that she has earned our respect. And so shall it be known. And, again, I cried a little bit.
Yep. And Harry notices at one point that they're all women that Murph called over. Jesus.
Mab, yeah. For Christ's sake. After they lay her body down and they leave, he realizes that they had all been female. Yeah. And then he shares a quiet moment with her body and is talking to her and says, I have to go. And, you know, I think he touches her forehead again, tells her Mabs is ready to make her play. He has to be there. And there's this bit with one of her curls keeps falling over her eye and he tries to move it and it keeps falling back.
I love that. Even in death, I could not make her do anything.
Yeah. And then he leans over and kisses her forehead and says, I already miss you so much. And then I cried again. Mm-hmm. And this is when he gets up and turns around and almost bumps into Mab because she's standing so close. And then he says, but I didn't, because you don't just be bumping into the Queen of Arendarr. It simply isn't done. And that really made me laugh.
Yep. And she has like a sort of interesting reaction to the burn on his arm. Mm-hmm. He says that mm-hmm. she says it, that must hurt, but there's like a tone of jealousy in her mm-hmm. voice. That's mm-hmm. like sort of weird. And then
she says, can you fight? And he says, watch me.
And she says, I will.
Yeah, and she says, you will see something the world has not seen in many years. And he's like, well, what? And she, her answer is, Mab at war. And I was like, all right, mm-hmm. this is, you know, all right, so we're about to ramp up. And then she says something very cryptic because it's hard to keep everything in, you know, if for me, keep track of everything because, again, so much is going on in this book, and there's all these different threads and shit from, like, feels like it was 3 books ago when it was really just the beginning of this book or the end of the last book. But there is a plan. We just, as readers, don't know it yet.
Correct.
Right? So, Mab says to him, when the moment is right, it must be you who calls out her name. And Harry says, I knew who she was talking about. There was no need for explanation. Which I'm like, I beg to fucking differ. Mm-hmm. I would like a little bit of an explanation. Yeah. I don't know who you're talking about. But Mab says, she will answer you. She has before. And then there is a little bit of talk about what would happen if Mab should fall. If she doesn't make it through tonight. And it turns out her last command is, kill Molly Carpenter as quickly as possible.
Yeah. What do you think?
Well, I mean, Mab says, her thinking says, you know, basically, like, she's not ready to be Mab. She's not ready to become Mab. The consequences would be unsettling for both of you, perhaps for all of Winter.
I don't get how it's, like, less unsettling to just not have a lady or mother of Winter, though. You know what I mean?
Well, if he kills, if Mab goes down and then he turns around and kills Molly, that just leaves the crone, right? The mother. And then, if Mab goes down, then Molly goes up, right? She goes up to Mab. And then if Mab gets her way, Harry then kills her. Another Winter Lady has to pop up, right?
Right. But who? That's right? My thing. It's like, you're like, well, she's not ready for this, so I'm just going to put a couple people who are both not ready as Winter Queen and Winter Lady instead. Or maybe that's not how it works, but I don't know that. So it just sounds like, well, we're just going to have no monarchy left except for, like, the mothers who are not involved in the day-to-day stuff, it doesn't seem like, anyway.
I thought, and again, we don't have a lot of information, and then a lot of the information that I do have is already out of my brain, but it felt like when we saw Molly become the Winter Lady, it was just because of proximity, right? Like, even though it wasn't just proximity, like, it was all orchestrated.
Right.
But the nuts and bolts of it is, Maeve is killed, and then Molly just happens to be standing there, and boom, right?
Right.
So if Harry kills Molly in a crowd of people, does just, like, the next fucking, like, what happens?
Well, and see, like, the thing with Molly was that she had been prepped by Mab. She had been prepped by the Lenanshi. With a lot of personal tutelage that, like, put her in a place where she understood the fairy mindset and stuff. And that's supposed to be part of why she qualified. So.
Oh, I didn't. Oh.
Yeah.
I remember that, you know, that she spent a lot of time with Leah when Harry was, you know, supposed to be dead. But I think I interpreted that as being, like, they were preparing her because ultimately they had an idea of what they wanted to happen. But that it wasn't necessary. It wasn't necessary for that preparation in order for her to become Winter Lady, right?
Like, I read that it was. Like, that was the way that, because of the way that Harry describes who was somebody who had been, you know, close to Winter for a while and had been instructed by somebody. And, you know, basically he names all of these things and was like, and was close enough. Came, like, last. The fact that her actual physical proximity It was like, yeah, that's part of it. But also the fact that she has had so much contact that she has, like, it almost felt like winter clinging to her a little bit. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I think I took it a little bit differently. Like, I thought that when he was listing all of that, it was more of like him realizing that they had been playing a much longer game than he realized.
Okay.
But that,
I mean, it could be both also.
Right. So, but either way, it leaves me and you both with, like, no answers for, like, what do you do with this vacuum? If he kills Molly after Mab dies, like, what happens? Mm-hmm. I get there's a lot going on. And also, she has said this ridiculous thing to him. So, he's not really, like, asking a lot of follow-up questions. But.
Yes.
But I would have loved for him to be like, and who's going to be in charge if you two are both dead? Is it me? Am I in charge? Is the Winter Knight like the surrogate? Does he become, what do you call it? Like, is he become like King Regent if there's no maybe. Winter Lady and no Mab?
He might be Queen Regent. Who knows how that would go? It's a very matriarchal system.
Yeah. But it's funny, it's not funny, but like she says, you know, kill Molly. And of course he's just like, that's really fucking funny. And then realizes it's not a joke, but he doesn't do what I expected was 5 pages about how there's no fucking way I'm killing Molly Carpenter. So you could just get the fuck out of my face with that bullshit. That doesn't happen.
Nope.
He says 2 things. One, that the idea of something that could kill Mab is so terrible, he can't even think about it. So his brain just like shuts down. Mm-hmm. And then he says basically, well, I'm not going to have to kill her because we're all going to be fine. This is going to work out. None of us are going to die tonight. And the conversation just moves the fuck on.
He doesn't even know. I think you misread that. He doesn't think something that could kill Mab is terrible. She says the consequences of Molly becoming Mab would be unsettling. I try to think of the kind of situation that would unsettle Mab, and my mind shied away from it.
I'm sorry. They talked about her dying a little bit earlier. And he has the whole thing back and forth about, like, how could you die? You're immortal.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you're right. But, okay, so just the idea of something that would unsettle her is upsetting to him. Yeah. He can't even think about it. But, again, yeah, it turns out to be, like, not a big conversation because he just says, you know, nobody's dying tonight, basically.
Yep.
So I thought that was surprising. And maybe he just figured now is not the time to...
I think he's got too much grief in his head already to start playing around with hypothetical grief.
So, then they just move on to the other sticking point, which is the eye.
Yeah, this is interesting.
Yeah, so...
When I bury Murph, she's going to be holding the shattered key to that Titanic bitch's cell on Demon Reach in her hands. Mab's face blossomed into a carnivore's sharp grin. Not the eye? Fuck the eye, I said. She actually lifted a hand to cover her mouth, but I saw her eyes. I saw them smile. It was damned eerie. All upon the field tonight want that weapon. Your own White Council included. It is the primary reason they fight. I blinked. I looked out at the ruddy haze outside and spat a curse. Of course. That's why everyone was fighting beside Mab. Not to honor the treaty, at least not for all of them, but to secure a weapon that would give them an enormous advantage over any of the other accorded nations. And, yeah, this moment, it's very interesting. She seems, like, genuinely delighted that he isn't thinking, oh, yeah, I'm going to take that fucking weapon for myself. She's just like, you really, that, you, it just clearly hasn't even occurred to you. And that's what literally everybody else is doing, and you haven't even started to catch on. Oh, babe.
Yeah, this is a really, you know, I felt like him, like, just kind of disgusted and disappointed in everybody.
Mm-hmm.
Because even in this, like, everything has been sort of portrayed as this sort of great coming together in the face of adversity. You know, we're all, you know, in this together to fight this common enemy, you know. And while that is part of it, a much bigger part, in a much uglier part, is really just everyone's own greed and ambition and hunger for power.
Yep.
Which is kind of what it always comes back to. And it just is a bummer. Like,
yep. You know,
that's everyone is got their own agenda once again. Even when it looks like what we're doing is like this noble thing.
Mm-hmm.
And when she says this to him, you know, it just clicks immediately. And he's just like, you know, he can already imagine what the white council would say, you know.
Mm-hmm. I love that
bit. Too dangerous, could cause havoc, can't let the monsters have it, we'll lock it away, keep it safe, harumph, harumph.
I love that so much.
I really did too. And she says, if we get through this fucking battle tonight, if we are victorious against the Titan, that is only part of the fucking thing. Because the real fight is going to be who gets the eye. That's when the shit's really going to be a problem. And quite frankly, I thought that the fucking Titan was the problem. I thought that was enough of a problem. I didn't know we needed an additional problem. Silly me.
Yep. I got three eyes already. What the hell do I want with another big ugly one? What indeed, Mav said, as if I hadn't spoken. So then she says how fighting out there is going to be fun.
Mm-hmm.
And she takes off, and Harry has a moment left with Murph, and he takes her cig, and he's asking, you mind if I borrow it? And of course she doesn't answer, but her coat opens and shows the spare magazines. Mm-hmm. And he sort of takes that as like, yep, go ahead, here's this too.
Mm-hmm.
So then we go to 25.
Yeah, so...
You sound so tired.
This is, you know, big battle scene.
You sound positively mischievous.
This little bit about the dolphins really cracked me up. It's like two lines, but it just really made me giggle. Because the Fomar are using these, like, clicks to communicate.
Mm-hmm.
And nobody can really understand them. But it's loud enough that they're, you know, people are noticing it. And noticing when they're, like, getting faster and more close together and all that shit. But there's a bit when he is just like... Fuck, I hope they weren't like dolphins so that they could see us through all the haze with those clicks. And then he's like, yeah, nah, I don't think so.
Yeah, he's like, I'm not going to try and borrow more problems from these guys. I think we have plenty already to deal with.
So the main part of this is fucking the numbers that are coming towards them, which they don't know yet,
mm-hmm,
right?
Mm-hmm.
But he's got his banner going, and you know, he's able to communicate with all the winter creatures that are out there scoping shit out for him, and he gets a sort of an update on the enemy, and they are in the thousands, between 5,000 and 7,000.
Yep.
Says, and Harry's got like 800 people, right? And it's not looking great. But they decide that maybe what they can do is they can use this bridge. This is like a pedestrian bridge mm-hmm. that crosses over by the park somewhere. And they're going to take the bridge down. And that is going to be like, they're going to like post people up so that they have like high ground.
Yep.
And they'll just be able to shoot the FOMAR and whatever else is coming, like, you know, fish in a barrel.
Defilade. There was like two words going. He mentions them later. It's fine. We'll get there.
Yeah, they both come up later. So they have to get to the bridge, and they all like start heading there. And they're supposed to be going quietly, but then they realize that, like, 900 people together can't go anywhere quietly.
I love this, that it's, like, this sound, and then all of a sudden, all of the clicks stop, and then they start, like, mm-hmm. way faster. And Harry's like, mm-hmm. oh, they weren't expecting us to mm-hmm. do this. Mm-hmm. Okay, you know what? Actually, mm-hmm. we are something to be afraid of, a little yeah. bit. Like, there's this mm-hmm. sense of constantly feeling so overwhelmed and hopeless, but then yep. sometimes you stop and look at it, and you're like, no, we could fuck some of them up, for real. And it goes wildly back and forth, which feels very true to how you'd yeah. be feeling in the moment.
There's also something that happens to Harry where, and this was really confusing when I was reading it, which I guess is supposed to be because he was confused. He didn't know what the fuck was happening. He has a sensation of getting shot. And I'm like, holy shit, he got shot? His shield wasn't even up. What the fuck? Why isn't he? What's happening? And he's like, I know I got shot, but where's the pain? And there's no blood. And then he feels it on his shoulder and then one in his cheek. And he's just like, what the fuck? And then he realizes, and then we all realize, that he is feeling the connection that he has with everyone, the sort of intellectus, I guess, that's kind of happening, mm-hmm. is allowing him to feel as his people are dying, as they are getting hit. He can feel their pain. He can feel the terror, the confusion. And it's just a little bit here. But by the end of this chapter, it is so much.
Yeah.
Ugh.
Yep. This is a really interesting, like, storytelling device as well. Because it is one thing to tell your readers, 30 people got mowed down. And you can be like, ah, mm-hmm. that's a shame. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. But when you tell them, our main character, whom you've grown to really love and who already has experienced excruciating pain and loss tonight, is feeling the impact of every bullet all of them mm-hmm. are on the receiving end of, that's mm-hmm. not, oh, that's a shame. That's, come on, man, yeah. this is fucked yeah. up.
Exactly, exactly, exactly. Mm-hmm. And then, so, like, I feel like Butcher knows that he is really piling it on. So we get Randy. Who knew?
Fucking Randy.
I should have known the minute they gave this guy a fucking name, that was like the clue that he was definitely going to be making an appearance, right?
So that's true.
Harry, one of the first things Harry does is takes these trees down so that they have like a better, you know, not obstructing their view. And, has to be careful because, and this is another thing that keeps coming up, so much energy in the city that his spells are just like
fucking turbocharged.
Like, you know, yeah. like just like the slightest bit of will is all it's needed. He even says a little bit later on that like the magic that he was throwing around should have left him exhausted and needing a meal and recharging before he could do a single other thing. But it's so easy to throw the spells because it's just the air is so thick with all this energy that he has to be really careful when he takes these two trees down. And so he blasts the two trees in front of, like, you know, it's so weird that we have like this army of like regular people witnessing all of this shit that we've been reading about for 16 books. So Harry takes the trees down, and then out of nowhere you just hear Randy, we got a goddamn wizard on our side. Fuck those guys.
Oh, I love it.
Yeah, it's pretty good. And while everybody is yelling, you know, the whole crowd, you know, gets behind Randy and they're just like, fuck yeah! Harry is feeling two people bleed to death.
Yep.
Yeah. Like just
1,185 left.
Yeah. Yep. Yep. And then this is the countdown. It continues, you know. So Butters and Harry head to the bridge and Sonya takes the people around the sides and everything. And they're on the bridge and they end up facing the Fomar, who it's a lot of them.
Yep.
The description of them, it's always terrible. It's terrible this time, like it's been every other time. The motley crew of, I don't even know. He can't even tell us. There are just vaguely canine animals. Some were packs of shapeless, deformed things. Not human, not animal. Faces and bodies twisted and ugly. Coolest combination of expressed genes imaginable, which I don't even know what that means. What a weird sentence.
That's fair.
Some with arms too long for their bodies, shoulders too wide, and then others that just look a little bit more modern and a little bit more human. But, so, just like unimaginable creatures are storming through the city, and that's what they run into up on this bridge. And it's him and Butters. And then what does he say? When I got spotted, things got a little crazy.
I'm sending you an overhead view of this bridge because it is real weird looking. I know he says it's a serpentine winding thing, but I really wasn't getting it. And it is understandable why it takes Butter so long to cut through it. It's wild, right?
Oh, that's so crazy. That's a pedestrian bridge? Mm-hmm. Wow. You could not pay me to walk. I don't do bridges anyway. I don't walk across bridges. A bitch just be stuck sometimes. Aww. I just have to go. I will go so far out of my way to not have to be up on heights. Like, yeah.
It doesn't. That's why I can't tell if, like, it's tall enough that you wouldn't be able to see over the side. Would it matter to you if you couldn't see over the side? Would that, like, help or not?
It would be helpful. It would be helpful if I couldn't see over the side.
I kind of think you can. I'm going to send you this picture if it's, like, more of a zoomed in view, and it looks like it's sort of, I don't know. I'm interested if anybody listening has like crossed this bridge.
I don't like how this looks at all. I also like, I went in on the picture, mm-hmm. and this is all too wavy for me.
It's very like, wavy. It's kind of wild that this was like built because it's so impractical in a lot of ways, but I'll just send you, a close-up of the tighter loop, and it looks like the wall of the inside would be too tall to see over, really.
This is like the bean. This is mm-hmm. like, it's. This is like, oh, it looks cool from above. Who is getting the view just from above? Who is this for?
Yeah, that's a question. You see that?
Yeah, I'm looking at it now.
I don't know. Maybe it isn't quite tall enough. It looks taller than I would have expected. Yeah. But it looks like it really comes up to like maybe like torso yeah. level, but not really much higher than that.
Yeah. I don't care for any of this. No, thank you. I would rather not.
There have been some people talking about trying to do a meetup in Chicago once the books are wrapped, and like going and visiting this and like the Field Museum to see Sue and, you know, the bean and all that stuff.
Oh, that's fun. Right? Go to that graveyard and see the fucking...
Yeah. Go to the aquarium and see where that battle took place.
That does sound like a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Hey, what's going on with Butters and these red carrots?
I do not...
Is it like a video game? It's like a video game, right? He doesn't get to tell us, but it has to do, like... Are these little red carrots over evil things that give him permission that's who he can smite? What's happening there?
I can't say.
Also, Harry, what the hell do vegetables have to do with anything? sir.
The wrong kind of carrot.
And then All Butter says this is kind of a night thing. And then there's, again, just no time. You know, there's no time to get into it because they're literally getting shot at. So.
Yep.
Then they start throwing or lobbing, really, grenades over.
Yes.
To Harry and Butters. And Harry's got them, like, behind his shield. And they are, like, belly crawling across this fucking bridge with the shield up. And then Harry sends Butters to kill the bridge. And I was like, and with what? Because, you guys, it did not for a second occur to me that he could hack through this fucking bridge.
Yeah.
Was that something that we were all supposed to just be like, yeah, of course he can do that?
We saw him cut through a rock. When his sword didn't cut through Sonya, they were like, does it work? And then he cuts through a rock.
But that was a rock in somebody's yard.
So?
That is, in my opinion, is an entirely different situation than cutting through steel and concrete. But it doesn't matter because he cut right through that shit. Like it was butter. Like, what is Harry's?
I'm so sorry. All right,
I'm going to wrap this up for the night. It's already been over an hour. Let's wrap this up. But yeah, he fucking slices right through it. And that leaves Harry to kind of like deal with the oncoming troops while Butters is taking care of the bridge. And we get a you shall not pass moment.
I swear to God, this guy.
Because he cannot help himself. Mm-hmm. And I mean both Harry Dresden and Jim Butcher.
True.
And so this goes on for a while. And they get finally, Butters is successful. He gets like a chunk in the middle of the bridge, right?
Yeah.
So they don't take like the whole thing down, but a chunk in the middle, so it not really working as a bridge anymore. And all the Fomar kind of like dive off the bridge to like the little highway that's underneath it.
Mm-hmm.
And we have Harry and Butters sort of like, what do you call it?
Oh my God. Did you hear the noise my throat just made?
Is that what that was?
Christ, getting old is such a scam. I haven't had a sip of water in an hour. And my throat is acting like it is just finally closing up after the last sip of water. What the fuck is this kind of service? I expected better.
Ugh. I believe your warranty has expired, and everybody knows that's when everything goes to shit. As soon as your warranty expires.
I need to go to the Genius Bar and get some help.
Do you have Apple Care? I don't think that you do. That's the first thing I gotta say.
I have Blue Cross Blue Shield. No.
What is like right underneath Genius? Because you're not getting a Genius Bar at Blue Cross Blue Shield.
You're getting you're getting Employee of the Month there. I wouldn't call him a genius. Like, he's very good.
There's adequate. Mm-hmm. The adequate bar. The slightly above average bar.
Oh, the adequate bar. Man. That's a good name for just like a real bar, actually. Look, we know what you're here for. And that's what we've got. We've got adequate alcohol.
Or as the locals call it, the it'll do.
Exactly. There you go.
So the bridge is down. They've got like all the Fomar piled into this like this highway or whatever that's underneath the bridge. And then Sonya and his troops have been hiding out in the cut. They all jump out and it is just a massacre.
Mm-hmm.
The slaughter is indescribable, he says. And Harry thinks to himself, shit, we're winning. He's losing people. His count's still going down. But
it's the jinx.
He figures, you know, their losses, his losses, their losses versus the FOMAR, it's like not even close.
Yep.
And soon as he fucking thinks it, here she comes.
Here she comes. Yep.
She comes striding out, 9 feet of terrible bronze beauty, he calls it. And everybody is firing. Don't matter. Doesn't matter. The bullets, whatever, it's not doing shit.
Yep.
She's just walking as if through a gentle rain. And she stands there and she checks everybody out.
And then, Harry's like, oh, wait a second.
Yep.
Yep.
Screams to try to get everybody off the bridge. And everybody just, like, it's just madness. You know, people are trying to move as fast as they can. It's not fast enough. Sonya sees it. They're running. They're screaming, yelling at everybody to retreat. But nobody can hear anything because of all the fucking gunshots. And then she just fucking turns the eye on them.
Yeah, it's rough.
It's fucking rough. And
did we skip over him having to go face-to-face with a FOMAR sorcerer who was, like, behind a veil?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we did.
It's fine. It's, like, just, you know, just another thing, honestly. Yeah.
And then that guy disappears, too. Like, he dips out. Mm-hmm. Like, he shows up, has a little bit of back and forth. He throws, like, that sludge that, like, eats, like, acid that, you know, just fucking melts everything.
Yep.
And then disappear.
Yeah, I guess he had a flicker of will and a muttered word. Yeah. And oh no, and he bats the grenade out of the... I thought that was him leaving. We don't hear about him again. Yeah, what happened to him? He just vanished.
Harry says something like, well, they don't believe in staying and fighting when they got like minions that they could just throw at me.
That's right, yep. Which makes sense. Look. I'm not going to lie. I don't think I'd have a better attitude.
If I had minions, y'all would never see me.
Mm-hmm.
I wouldn't be nowhere near none of this.
Like, I would maybe get my minions, like, health insurance, maybe.
Oh, well, they'd have a profit-sharing plan and all that good shit.
Yeah, but...
You know, but
also, I'm not trying to be, like, a floor manager. I want to be an office manager.
Right?
Corporate. Like, thank you.
Exactly. So Harry sees all this coming, right? He knows what she's about to do, tries to get everybody away, can't, and then has to feel it when all of these people die at once.
Yep.
And they don't just die.
I know.
Turns out.
Can't
just die. They don't just die bad. He says they died badly. And then it's not just that the fire that she made, right? But he says, whatever pain they feared most, they felt as they died. Images of despair and doom flashed in that fire. And so much fear that many of my people went mad in the partial second of suffering they had left before their bodies were broiled and blasted to dust. And I felt it with them. 732. For fuck's sake.
Yeah.
Why?
Yep.
It's just so much. It's so much.
Is it for fuck's sake, like it's the fuck's sake, like possessive? Or is it fuck's sake, like it's there's no apostrophe and it's just for the sake of fucks in general?
Oh.
Do you know what I'm saying?
I believe in the possessive. The you know.
So it's the for the sake of fucks.
For fuck's sake, yes.
It is.
The sake belongs to fucks.
There it is. The sake belongs to fucks. I was trying to get the words out, and I kept twisting myself around. All right. the same.
Because otherwise it would just be a plural, right? It'd be for fuck's sakes, but it would just be multiple fucks.
Well, that's kind of like, some people say for fuck's sake, and some people say for fuck's sakes, and they do say it plural.
Oh, you mean making sakes plural, too.
Yeah, well, like, either one. Like, does it change the meaning if you make it plural? The questions that I want an answer to.
Yeah, guys. I don't, like, I don't have an answer for that.
It doesn't matter in any way, but, like, I
want to
know.
My personal use is possessive and singular sake. It's for fuck's sake.
Okay. Do you remember that bit in Crazy Ex-Girlfriend when she can't figure out the spiders club and the apostrophe moves around depending on the promotion?
Oh my god, yes!
Like, is it, does it belong to somebody named Spider, or is it like full of spiders, or does it like belong to multiple spiders?
That is a really underrated bit, and it does keep showing up
like when over and over. It's very good. That's really, it gives proof to the whole, like, the more you do a joke, the funnier it gets.
Commitment to the bit.
Yep.
I said it before and I'll say it again. But, so, yeah, 732. It hurt so much that I couldn't breathe. Yeah. Same. Harry Dresden. Same. And he feels like, yeah, winning. What the fuck was I thinking?
Yeah.
2 seconds ago when I thought that to myself. And he says, mortals could not stand against that. And, yeah, she lifted her hand, the gesture elegant, and pointed it forward with one finger. And the Fomar army surged forward. And it ends with our heroes running for their fucking lives.
Yep.
And most of the volunteers don't make it.
Mm-hmm.
And exactly 87, in fact, had been injured and could not run, and they went down fighting. 645. Yeah. 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 So
on that cheery note, we will be pausing until next week. Hurrah.
When you didn't think this shit could get worse, resumes next week.
Welcome to You Thought That Was Bad. Our weekly segment.
My God, is this just so much awfulness packed in? It's a lot.
Yep.
I mean,
this is part of why. Look, I've had some suggestions for things to cover in our between times, and a lot of people have suggested the Broken Earth series by M.K. Jemisin. And look, it's an amazing series; it's super good. But also, we've had a lot of this sort of energy.
Yeah.
And that is a lot more of this sort of energy, except in a context that feels a lot more personal.
Oh, yeah. No, thank you.
It is too much right now. And I think you guys get it. I really bet you do. I can't. And I know Rashawn can't. Mm-mm. We don't need to be
can
doing
it. Can I tell you how I am? I cannot wait till we get to Ted Lasso.
I'm saying, you know, like, we,
like, I'm super excited you're going into the Sookie Stackhouse books, even though, like, I don't know the books. I only know the show, and I understand that they're actually pretty different, right?
Yeah, they are very. Their tone is like completely.
I don't know if the books are darker than the show. The show was so campy, but I feel like it's hopefully a little bit lighter fare for you guys.
It's definitely lighter fare than what we have been covering.
Right?
Yeah.
So I'm excited for you guys to embark on that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And there's also, I had mentioned to Rashawn, because I stopped covering Stranger Things after season 2. And I never watched the third season because there was a sort of possibility that I might go back and cover it. And then season four came out and everybody is just talking about how great it is. And it's supposed to be the last season.
I can't tell you anything about it. So I'll be quiet.
I've heard a lot of good feedback. Like within the space of 2 days going out to Owen's niece's graduation, and texting friends, I had like 4 people go, "Have you watched the new season yet?" And when I said no, going, "Oh," because they just want to talk about it. Yeah. So it's on the table potentially. I'd be interested to hear how many people would want to listen, because it would be picking up with a new host. Rashawn didn't host the first 2 seasons with me. And it's been literally years now since, you know, we had covered that.
I remember when you did cover it, you had a similar problem with the other Netflix shows at the time where they do the drop and it's the whole thing at once. So everybody is consuming it at the same time, pretty much over a weekend, mm-hmm. and then it's like done.
Yeah.
And I don't know if that's a concern for you or not, because we'd have to watch and then record on 3 before we even got to 4. And by the time we got to 4, everybody is going to be like on to the next whatever, you know?
Right. Yeah. So it's like a question. I am curious, like, do you guys care enough about it that you would want to wait for coverage of it? And with, I think with season 2, at the time I was recording with Maggie, and I think we recorded like 3 episodes at a time. We did something like we accelerated it.
You did, because you were trying to, like, at least keep it sort of current, right. You know? So you guys covered multiple episodes at once. I'd be very curious what people think, too. I don't know. It's difficult for me to gauge because, you know, everything that we cover has to be covered. It's never, like, timely. Right. Except when we were doing, like Game of Thrones, mm-hmm. you know. Mm-hmm. Those were sort of timely. But that's pretty much the only thing that we've ever done. Usually we wait till everything is done before we record. You know, we did The Leftovers. It was kind of already after it was, you know, it happened. Westworld, we came too late. So I don't know. I am really enjoying season 4. I cannot remember season 3 at all. I know I watched it. You guys, when I pulled up season 4 to watch, I was like, well, let me rewatch season 3. And you know how Netflix will let you know if you already watched something? Mm-hmm. That was, every episode was like a full red bar. I was like, oh, I watched all this shit already.
Yeah.
No memory of it. No memory.
Yeah, that's the thing that sort of concerns me a little bit. Because I didn't really hear that much buzz around season 3. A lot of people seemed sort of whatever about it. But I don't want to like just skip it either. So,
I mean,
I'm just putting it out there, and this would not be like instead of Ray Bearer, cause I definitely want to cover Ray Bearer, but, it's sort of uncertain how much time we're going to have between books for Dresden going up forward. So it's a good thing to have some stuff that's sort of in the barrel. Yeah. Is that the way you say that? Chamber. Bullet in the chamber. That's what I'm trying to say.
Well, I say watch 3 on your own, even though I know this goes against everything you believe in. Just watch 3 so you can say you watched it, and then let's just do 4.
All right. Well, I won't, but noted.
Maybe other people will back me up, and people will let you know.
What a weird, like, I'm just picturing somebody, like, coming up upon the Stranger Things feed. And I've covered seasons 1 and 2 very carefully. And then 3, there's like 1 episode of me going, it was fine. And then season 4, premiere. I'm just like, wait, what?
People will be like, I get it.
Maybe. Maybe they'll be like, oh, thank God. Yeah, that's what it deserved.
I don't even, you know, it's funny. I am, like, talking all this shit, you guys. But it's not even that I think season 3 was bad. You know, I don't remember.
I don't recall.
And I don't want to, there's a couple of pieces that I think might be from season 3. But then when I look into it, I'm like, oh, wait, no, that was season 2. And I can't talk about any of it with you because you haven't seen 3 and I don't want to accidentally spoil you.
Yeah, so. Don't fuck with me. Don't do it.
Yeah, I won't do it. Patrons, new or not, so we can wrap this up so a bitch can go to bed.
Listen, you can't make them feel like this. They deserve to feel appreciated and loved. They deserve the dignity of the air horn. This week we've got drink water. That's the end. Thank you, drink water. Always good advice. Everybody, please take a moment right now to get yourself a beverage and hydrate. Something non-alcoholic, preferably. Maybe without that caffeine.
Is so classy.
I love this thing. And if I do get on the circle, it's coming with me. And every time that there is an alert, I'm going to press it.
You're going to try to steal some of the alert shot?
Yes. Because that's a... Ba-da-na-na-na-na-na. No, it's going to be... Because that's what it does. Maybe only for like special alerts. Maybe if I know that this is going to be like the ranking alert or something like that.
Oh, yeah. That's what you do.
Yeah.
Your air horn will rank the alert. If the alert is good enough, then it gets an air horn. If you're not impressed with that alert, no air horn for you.
All right. So if it's an alert that's while I'm like in the middle of cooking breakfast, I'm just like, ugh. But if I've been sitting, reading a book, waiting, nothing for 2 hours... That will get an air horn. I'm going to be fine. So, oh, thank God. Something. Is there a cake outside my door to decorate? Give it to me. Anyway. All right. Guys, thank you all so much for listening. We love you. Thank you, Drinkwater, for becoming a patron. Appreciate you a great deal.
We do.
And hope y'all are enjoying the content and the Discord and whatnot. I had a lot of people listening to the last episode cried while they were listening. And apologies to making y'all cry. It's the Dobby situation all over again. But I hope that I did it justice. I had some people who were afraid I wouldn't be able to get through it because I was crying. But honestly, I was like so angry still. That sort of overrides the cry reflex because it's just like this sort of cold rage under it all. So, all right, everybody.
Telling everybody all your secrets.
Well, you know, sometimes I could turn it off a little bit. But with Dobby, like, I can't turn that off. Anyway, all right. Guys, we love you. Until next time, toodaloo, motherfuckers.
Bye, guys.
Was an Unspoiled Network podcast.